All right, this is John Colin with OKRaw.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. And this is an evening with John. The sun's about to set and I'm here in my garden and I thought I'd just sit down and have a chat with you guys. This video is specifically for the reason about how to get better results from your raw food vegan diet. I mean, these principles work for any diet for that matter, but I am focused around a raw vegan diet. Now, if you guys don't know me, I know some of you guys are my subscribers, but some of you guys don't know me. I've been doing a raw foods diet since 1995, and all during that time, I've always asked myself the question in my head, how can I improve my diet and make it even better than it was yesterday? I mean, for the past 26 years or however long I've been doing it. And I come up with a lot of different ideas. Some work and some don't work. But in this video, I want to basically get down to the ones that really helped me a lot. That I want you guys to know that a lot of raw food teachers out there don't really talk about or maybe don't think are that important. I personally feel all these tips are very critical and important. And I want you guys that are watching this to include or do at least one or maybe two of these guys. Some of them are not really hard to implement into what you are already doing. Some may be a bit more challenging, but they will all benefit you greatly in the long run. You know, just like to be a millionaire, you got to put $100 in the bank, you know, for, you know, every month or whatever. And it adds up and it compounds. And by the end, you have a lot of money. And that's to me like your health. It's my health bank account. I'm literally putting money in the bank every time I make a better choice with my diet. Every time I use some of my tips, you know, it increases my health bank account, in my opinion, so that I get better results. All right. So I guess without further ado, let's get into this episode. So the first tip is, without even changing anything else about your raw foods diet, I want you guys to source higher quality and better produce. What does that mean to me? That means fresher picked. The sooner you could buy it after it is off the vine, the higher quality of the food. Of course, also the riper the food is when it's picked, in general, the more nutrients it will have. In addition, another benefit is if it's picked and then you buy it, you know, it's not gonna spoil as quickly as something that's been picked a long time ago. I mean, if you guys are still buying apples right now in the summertime and they're not being imported from outside the country, they're from last, you know, fall and they've been sitting around in cold storage. I recently saw a study that shows the decline of the vitamin C over time of cold storage apples. It's absolutely insane. So that's another reason to eat seasonally. Today, you know, I had figs from a local farm. I had some cherries, you know, we'll be talking about that in a minute. But it's very important to source the best quality food. Every week I go out to farms or farmers markets to source the best quality food. When I travel, I always visit farms and farmers markets to get the highest quality food. If you guys aren't lucky enough to have a farm or farmers market near you, search for one. And aside from that, I mean, the best you guys could do is maybe, you know, buy things in bulk from the grocery store, the health food store on the day it comes in. So you get it literally fresh off the truck so it's not sitting in the back and then being put out. Another tip I want to give you guys is shop more often. You know, I know some of you guys might go shopping like once a week for your produce. It'd be best to, you know, stop by that produce market every day on the way home from work and, you know, pick up the greens that you're going to eat that night, that day, and then prepare them right then and there. Don't buy them and then let them sit in your fridge for a week or two. They might go bad, and actually that happens to a friend of mine. She always buys a bunch of different greens and stuff, and then she lets them sit and they go bad, and then she basically wastes money even though she has the best intention of using them. So that's why I would also encourage you guys to shop more often if you are able. My next tip, as I sit here in my garden, we got peppers here, we got eggplants there, we got tomatoes there, we got basil over here. I don't know what you guys can see on the camera. We got some tree collards here, some dandelions, some mint over there. But the next tip is grow your own food. Nobody does it better than you. You could grow higher quality food than what industrial farming or even your local farmers are supplying. I'm 100% confident in this. I've, you know, researched the food system. I've been living in the food system. I visit farms and farmers markets. I see what they're doing. And some are, you know, going above what they need to do. But honestly, you know, you could do a lot better in your own garden by growing your own food, by adding the different trace minerals in forms of rock powders and ocean solids and things like kelp and even phytoplankton, which I don't know any farms that use phytoplankton. You could also add things like compost teas and different trace minerals, bacteria and fungi and archaea and all the different microbes that it takes to make the soil food web work, which has quite big parallels with our microbiome and our digestive system and how that works. In addition, if you guys are growing your own food, you could grow a much wider variety of food than what is available at the grocery store. You could grow different wild foods. I'm growing, like right now, purslane comes up every year in my garden. Lamb's quarters comes up every year in my garden, like unannounced. And I eat it, I juice it, right? These are foods not commonly eaten. In addition, you can select foods. Check out rareseeds.com. You can buy different seeds from all over the world to grow different varieties and cultivars of foods that you can literally not find in a grocery store. And that's completely amazing. Plus, of course, if you're growing your own, you know, this pepper that right here will not get harvested until the moment before I'm gonna eat it. I'm gonna harvest it and pick it and probably vacuum blend it up and then put it in a salad dressing or something like that. But other than that, it stays fresh on the vine, absorbing more sun energy, absorbing more minerals, and creating more antioxidants while it's still attached to the plant. My third tip is I want you guys really to focus on phytonutrients while still making sure you get enough calories, right? There are many camps of raw foods that just, calories are the most important thing, you need to get a lot of calories and all this stuff, and hey, we need to get a proper amount of calories, and I'm not gonna debate that. But what I will debate is how we can get those calories. A lot of raw food diet styles get their calories from fruit. And in the fruit camp, some raw food diet styles in the fruit camp get a lot of their calories from things like bananas. To me, bananas are a very low phytonutrient food. They don't have things like anthocyanins. Maybe if you get the fahy bananas that are orange or the red bananas, you might have a little bit higher levels of beta carotene. But to me, bananas are just calories. To me, bananas are like the white sugar to, you know, whole food vegans, because they don't have a lot of nutrition in them. Do I still eat bananas? Absolutely. Also, I don't like how imported bananas taste because I've had really good bananas before, so I try not to eat them that much, but they are a good source of fiber and some nutrients, and I do like diversity in my diet, which I'll be talking about in a little bit. But I really want you guys to focus on foods that have higher levels of phytonutrients. Berries, you know, complete opposite of the bananas, like wild blueberries. Hey, if you're gonna eat some bananas, blend it up with some wild blueberries under vacuum, as you'll learn in a little bit. So at least you're offset the amount of bananas you're eating, because now you're gonna get some blueberries. Or instead of bananas, eat persimmons. I love persimmons more. They're a lot more phytonutrient rich than bananas. They're also fairly high calorie. You know, today I ate figs and cherries. You know, I'd rather eat those than bananas. They're a lot more phytonutrient rich. Of course, you know, figs and cherries also cost more than bananas too, so I guess it also depends on your budget, you know. But that being said, I can't put a price on my health. My health is priceless. So, you know, instead of buying 69¢ a pound bananas, you know, I bought $4.50 a pound cherries that are organic, on sale at Whole Foods this week for Prime members. That's unsponsored. In addition, of course, besides just the fruits, I really want you guys to focus on the vegetables. Vegetables are nutritional powerhouses and more phytonutrient rich and calorie poor than fruits are, of course. You know, that's why I grow many different leafy greens in my garden. And this time of year, I got things like tree collards, I got green onions, I got Malabar spinach growing up the vine in the back. I try to eat a wide variety of different greens. Oh, including my basil. Basil are my number one greens that I like to eat in the summertime because they're so easy to grow for me. And also, they're antioxidant packed. They can get quite strong as well. You know, I actually make a juice with a honeydew, melon, and basil. And that's a trip. So I want you guys to focus more around your diet around phytonutrients instead of just thinking about getting the calories in, okay? I think that'll be a really helpful thing that could make big changes in the long run. Fourth tip, I want you guys to have diet diversity. Very important. I see a lot of raw food as some of my friends that just will go shopping every week, go to the produce terminal every week and get the same exact oranges, bananas, you know, dandelion greens and a red lettuce or whatever they get every single week, and they'll get the same exact, you know, food items every time on their shopping list because that's what they eat. And hey, if you guys want to do that, that's great. I think that in order to improve your diet and take it to the next level and get more benefits, you can do that by having a greater diet diversity. You know, every time I go shopping, I don't have a shopping list. It's rare that I ever have a shopping list. I'm an opportunistic shopper. Whatever is organic and on sale and looks like really good, or if it just looks really good and like it's in season and I haven't had it in a while, I'm just gonna buy it. You know, because I want to eat a lot of different kinds of foods and not eat the same exact foods every single week. Because when you do that, that's great. You probably like them. You get a very limited amount of different nutrients that are in those foods, but then you don't get nutrients that are in different foods. In addition, every summer, spring, and fall, and winter, I'm growing different kinds of plants in my garden. I strive to grow new and exciting varieties that I've never grown before because every plant produces different kinds of plant metabolites, also known as phytonutrients, you know, which are good for us to eat. So I'm always striving to include different foods. I go to Asian markets, I'll get some foods there that I haven't eaten or tried. You know, their Asian markets are excellent for fruits, even some Mexican markets in town, really excellent for, you know, purchasing some food, some plant foods that you may have never, fruits and vegetables you've never seen before. One of my tips for you guys is every time you go to the produce section to go shopping for produce, buy one item that you haven't bought before, or if you have eaten everything in the produce section, like I have, buy something that you haven't eaten in quite a long time and you forget what it tasted like. That way you could have a better diet diversity. If you always make salads out of lettuce, hey, lettuce is great, I love lettuce, but hey, make a kale salad, make a celery salad, make a bok choy salad, you know, make a salad out of dandelion greens, that's not gonna taste too good. Make a spinach salad, you know. There's many different kinds of greens besides just lettuce. So I want you guys to think outside the box and eat a more diverse diet. Fifth tip I wanna give you guys is I want you guys to concentrate your nutrients. You know, in my personal opinion, you know, industrialized food of this day and age is devitalized. They're not adding the level of different trace minerals in the soil or microbes in the soil to create plants with very high nutritional profiles. And the foods today don't have literally the vitamins and minerals that foods from like the 1950s had. This is why I like to concentrate my nutrients by removing some of the properties of the food. For example, I could juice. If I juice, I remove some, but not all the fiber. I remove the insoluble fiber, but keep the soluble fiber. And so like the soup I made yesterday was 2 gallons of bell pepper juice. I couldn't eat that many bell peppers, but by juicing and removing some of the fiber, I could now take that bell pepper juice and blend it up with guacamole to make my guacamole soup that I basically made with other different kinds of fruits and vegetables, including arugula this week. You know, so juicing is an excellent way to allow you to get more and pack in more of those valuable phytonutrients and minerals that, you know, may be lacking in the food of this day and age due to, you know, plant breeding as well as, you know, fertilizing and how the food is grown and harvested. Another way you guys can concentrate nutrients are by eating dried foods. If I'm eating something dried, I always like to have it with water or, you know, blend it, vacuum blend it into a smoothie like, you know, berry powders or fruit powders or green powders. This removes the water from the food to concentrate more nutrients in there. Now, if you want to be the best, you could combine fresh made juice with some powders, green powders or fruit powders to basically, you know, take your diet to the next level because you will really be concentrating the phytonutrients at that point. My sixth tip is simply get better equipment. You know, if you're a carpenter or, you know, a construction worker, you need to have, you know, a hammer, a screwdriver, and all your tools to make it happen. Likewise, as a raw foodist, I've literally specialized and probably the number one expert in the world about equipment to process the raw fruits and vegetables in the best way possible to retain the highest level of nutrients. This has been my quest. Not many people talk about this once again. So, you know, by improving your equipment, instead of using a high-speed Breville juicer, you know, I know some of you guys still own that, upgrade to a slow juicer. This is a much more gentle process, grinds up better, extracts more phytonutrients, and will, you know, not lose as many antioxidants and sense air-sensitive polyphenol compounds due to the high rate of oxygenation that's happening in a high-speed juicer. In addition, I want you guys to upgrade your blender. Seriously, guys, upgrade your blender. I know a lot of you guys own Vitamixes. Vitamixes destroy nutrients faster than anything else. Traditional blending with oxygen, with atmospheric oxygen levels, you know, which is what most people own, can destroy 2 to 3 times more of different antioxidant vitamins and certain polyphenols from the published scientific study I have seen. In addition, there's manufacturer's data, and in addition, there's just my personal testimonial of how different the food tastes that I vacuum blend. In addition, vacuum blends don't add oxygen, dissolved oxygen, into the blend as much, so you don't get the gas, belching, or bloating that you would with a normal smoothie. Plus, another side benefit is that your smoothie will last longer. You ever make a banana smoothie in your Vitamix and you let it sit for a couple hours and you drink it later, tastes horrible? That won't happen if you vacuum blend, because you have not damaged the antioxidants during the blending process, so they're there to protect the food later on. Vacuum blending is a key essential one, and just by changing out your blender, even if you don't do any of these other things, you will be improving your diet. You'll be getting more of these valuable phytonutrients in you, and I believe you will get more health benefits from them. Post a link down below on how I now juice in my vacuum blender. You know, this is surely next level, and that's the best way to juice also. Vacuum juicing and vacuum blending for the win. My 7th tip to you guys is experiment outside the box. There's many different raw food camps, and everybody likes to be in their raw food camp, whether it's an 80-10-10 camp, a fruitarian camp, an Ann Wigmore camp, a Hippocrates diet camp. There's all different kinds of ways to do raw foods. It seems to me that a lot of the ways promoted online are more towards a fruit-based diet, you know, which I believe can work if you get enough vegetables. But that being said, I don't want you guys to trench yourself in to any one diet style. I want you guys always to remain flexible to other diet styles. And although, you know, if something that you're doing in your diet style doesn't seem right, or more importantly, you're changing over time because maybe you've done, you know, this diet style for 5 years now, exactly the same, and you're no longer getting the benefits you used to. Maybe you need to adjust and modify and move on and do something a bit different. You know, that's what I've done over the many years. I've found, you know, Ann Wigmore style raw foods, you know, 80-10-10 or more natural hygiene style raw foods. I saw how each of those worked for me for a time, and then I moved on and kind of, you know, used components of each of those, as well as Hippocrates diet, as well as other diet styles, and then made them my own. I do my own style diet. There's nowhere that explains what I do. I'm trying to explain some of it in this video. And I think very important, especially if you're eating a high fruit diet, which can totally work. You know, I'm not here to knock fruit, but I would say that you basically need to make sure you eat enough vegetables. I found a lot of people that eat a lot of fruit tend to basically shy away from the vegetables, especially the leafy green vegetables, and that's why I like juicing so much, or just vegetables in general. Vegetables in general are very important to balance out the fruits, and of course we want to eat enough fats, but not too much fats. I'm not sitting here pouring olive oil on stuff. I would rather eat olives instead. I ate a whole avocado today, but I'm not eating any other nuts or seeds today. You know, so I want you guys to remain a little bit flexible outside the box of the raw food camp that you've put yourself in. It's kind of like the sorting hat in Harry Potter, right? Everybody's in their camp and they don't want to talk to their camp, and they're the bad guy. I think we could all be friends, and everybody just needs to kind of pick and choose different elements of each camp because they all have some validity to them. I think it's sad how I've seen some people on YouTube like stick to one camp, and then it leads to, you know, videos like why I no longer eat raw foods, because they're so trenched into that camp and to only believe those beliefs didn't exactly work for them. And I believe if they would have been maybe open up their mind a little bit to like other camps and maybe doing things a bit differently, they could have absolutely succeeded. And that's what I want for you guys. My 8th tip, and this is a more recent one in my diet, I want you guys to consider a diversity of fibers. As the scientific studies come out more and more research comes out, you know, it is more apparent to me than ever on how important fiber is, especially the soluble fiber, to our microbiome. They feed our microbiome, and if you have certain gut buddies in you, you could be healthier or not. How can you ensure that you have a bigger diversity of gut buddies? Well, there's a study that showed just juicing can increase the diversity of your gut buddies, or beneficial probiotics or bacteria or fungi or archaea in your gut. But even more so than just juicing, I want you guys to do some of the other tips that I've talked about, right? Your gut buddies, besides eating fiber, will also eat things like polyphenols. You know, they love anthocyanins, based on the research I've seen, right? I want you guys to eat, once again, a wide variety of foods and consider the types of fiber. You know, when's the last time you guys ate aloe vera? Aloe vera has some very interesting fibers, polysaccharides, cactus leaves, which I haven't eaten lately. I need to eat those. I'm growing them. I could harvest them from the other side of my yard. Cactus fruits are now in season. I want you guys to experience some red cactus fruits rich in, that's a very high fiber food. And when's the last time you guys ate cactus fruits? Maybe you could wild harvest them near you. But yeah, I want you guys to consider the fiber in your diet. Most raw foodies don't consider fiber. Like, I get enough fiber. I eat tons of bananas. Well, yeah, if you're eating tons of bananas, that's great. You're getting a lot of the kind of fiber in bananas, but you're missing the fiber in peppers or in aloe vera or in cactus fruits. You know, many types of fiber. That's why diet diversity is important. Consider the fiber and try to even, eat different kinds of plant foods. That's why I said go to the store and buy that one plant food in the produce section you never bought before, because that has a different kind of fiber. Ninth tip that can seriously improve your benefits that you get from a raw foods diet is, this is a simple one, guys. You could all do this, cost you zero money. Chew your food better, right? You know, luckily I learned early on in my raw foods career that chewing your food was critical to your health. And you know, I'll often be one of the last people in the room to finish my salad because I'm like chewing it literally like into a mush every mouthful. This also keeps my jaw exercised, which is actually also very important because it's actually jaw strength and it actually tones up my facial structure. One of my many tips, so chew your food quite well, work out your muscles, very important. Also, you know, it'll mix it with your saliva and digestive enzymes and ptyalin and all these things and help you with the digestion process to make all that happen more smoothly. You know, there are no teeth in our stomachs. And so if you're swallowing, you know, pieces of lettuce or spinach whole, going and you swallow them whole, they're gonna basically come out whole. And I've seen some raw foodists, you know, from looking in the toilet bowl after they went to the bathroom, that they're just simply not chewing well. And it's like, why eat food at that point if you're not gonna chew it well to get optimal digestion out of your food? Now, if you're lazy, you know, then vacuum blend or juice it. So at least you're gonna liberate some of the nutrients from that. But I still think that despite using the equipment, I still chew plenty good, because chewing your food, in my opinion, is plenty important and a very easy tip you could all integrate. My 10th and final tip is, and this is going out to raw foods, is to think beyond raw foods. It's taken me many years to think beyond just eating foods that are raw. You know, for the most of my raw foods career, I've eaten 99% raw. And just more recently, I've introduced some heat processed foods into my diet, including the eggplants right here that I'm growing. They are completely amazing. I had some yesterday. I use an instant pot to heat process them for like 5 minutes. I'll have a video coming out soon on my gardening channel on how I process my eggplants. I would encourage you guys to eat plain, unsalted, unflavored, heat processed vegetables to increase your fiber diversity and micronutrient and, you know, polyphenol diversity as well. So, you know, the eggplants, very high in anthocyanins, also gives me a different kind of fiber that I would not normally get. And actually, I saw a study, this is a quite funny study. The study said, because normally raw foodists would dehydrate eggplant into eggplant bacon, the study said that basically if you're dehydrating eggplant, and they tested this in the study, you lose 80 to 90% of the antioxidants in the eggplant. But if you pressure cook them, you actually create more antioxidants, in the eggplant or the food that you'll be eating. Now, of course, you're losing all the enzymes, but what's more important, enzymes or antioxidants? And at this point in my raw foods journey, I would like to say, you know, I still eat plenty of enzymes in all my foods, aside from maybe my eggplants and aside from some heat processed beans or mushrooms, but those foods have additional benefits such as other kinds of fibers that I can't get on a raw foods diet. Some mushrooms and beans could be eaten raw, but I believe that by heat processing them, I could eat more of them, and I usually incorporate those heat processed foods into my raw food salad. So my soup this week, you know, has some heat processed mushrooms in there, and you know, they're served cold, but they've been heat processed to break down the chitin and remove some of the toxins that may be existing in the mushrooms. So I really want you guys to think outside the raw food box. I know a lot of you guys are not 100% hardcore raw foodists. That being said, you know, eating some heat processed foods could take you down a slippery slope, and I believe that slope occurs mainly when you have, you know, things added to the foods you're eating. So, you know, I'm not going out to eat at McDonald's or other vegan restaurants. I'm only heat processing in my Instant Pot. Basically, it's like steaming, but better because it preserves more nutrients, and just eating it plain and or with like a raw salad at the same time. This way, I haven't had any other kind of cooked food cravings or anything like that, and I believe this to be a benefit of my diet. That being said, you know, I'm not pigging out on these heat processed foods. They remain a very small portion of my diet just to get a little bit more diversity, feed my microbiome a little bit better so that in the end I could be healthier, because my goal is not 100% raw. It has always been about 100% health, because I almost lost my life when I was younger. I found that the raw food path was my way to do it, but I'm now finding that maybe by changing up a little bit and being open to other concepts, I could improve even more, and that's what I've shared with you guys today. Hopefully this video has been valuable to you and you will actually implement at least one or two of these ideas that I've shared with you guys today so that you can improve your diet, because that's why I'm here. I'm here to share the message about raw foods, eating more fruits and vegetables, and how you guys could be healthier on the planet, just sharing things that I've learned over all these years since I've been eating a raw foods diet that I started back in 1995, surely a lot longer than a lot of people making raw food videos on YouTube. So I hope you act upon some of my valuable information today. If you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, please be sure to share this video with somebody else that you think it could help on raw food forums or other whole food plant-based areas, or even with other nutritarians, because I would also consider myself a nutritarian. I'm really concerned about eating more phytonutrients and nutrient-dense foods than calorically dense foods that have been highly processed. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes that come out every 5 to 7 days, no matter where I show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are wealth of knowledge, over 600 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, dedicated to teach you guys all about how to eat more fresh fruits and vegetables the best way possible. And I teach you guys things that you literally will not hear on any other raw foods channel, because I have a lot of my own ideas that I've come up with and learned over the many years that I just feel free to share with you guys freely so that you guys can improve your diet as well if you guys want to. So with that, my name is John Kohler with OKRaw.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep eating your fresh fruits and vegetables. They're always the best.